Welcome to another episode of At the Table with Patrick Lencioni, where everything we talk about is related to changing the world of work so that more organizations can be more effective and less dysfunctional, and employees can be more fulfilled and less miserable. I'm your host, Pat Lencioni, joined by Cody Thompson, my co-host.
Hey, Pat, how's it going?
It's just the two of us today.
I know, unsupervised, and we're still on our best behavior.
That's right.
We don't get enough credit.
What's our topic today?
Our topic is, it's called It's a Strategy Thing.
That's right. And the reason why we say that is because we're going to go over a thing with you. We almost called it a thingy, a little model, a tool that I've been using for more than 20 years. It's not even ours. We want to give credit to Michael Treacy, the author of a book called The Discipline of Market Leaders. It's been around for a long time. One of the models that he presents in there is really fascinating. And we just want to go over it with you and give you some examples. And the reason why we're doing this is because if you're building a healthy organization, one of the things you have to have is a clear strategy. And in the work we do with companies, this is a big part of coming up with something we call one of their strategic anchors. You don't need to know what that means, but every company needs to answer the question that we're about to pose. And it's fun talking about it. Probably anybody out there doing anything in any kind of business format or any kind of organizational format needs to understand this. So we love this model. We think it'll be fun. Yeah, what were you going to say, Cody?
Yeah, I was just thinking the part of the reason we're doing this is because we end up talking about this so regularly that it just comes up in conversations. And I've had this conversation around this model, this discipline of market leaders triangle we're going to talk about, with people who are in existing organizations. And I have it a lot when friends of mine who are like, hey, I have this idea. I'm going to start this business, or I'm going to go out on my own. I'm going to be a coach. And it's even helpful to clarify, like, so what are you going to do? Which of these strategies are you going to employ? And it's just really helpful in clarifying in all of those conversations.
Yeah. Like, I have three people that I know listen to this, people that contact me about it. And whether you're running the transportation department for a big county, whether you're the chief legal officer, you're the head lawyer at a company, whether you're in sales of software and gaming tools, you need to understand this to put it all into perspective about what you do for your customers.
Yep.
Right? Okay. So let me try to describe this, Cody, without any physical attribute. I don't have a whiteboard or anything else. So I want everybody to imagine a triangle. Okay.
Done.
And here's the label on the three points of the triangle. At the very top, let's make it a triangle. I don't know, is that an isosceles triangle? Equilateral triangle.
Equilateral. Wow, look at us.
I finally used my geometry. At the top, I want you to write the words, or think about the words, product quality.
Or product leadership. So it's one of those.
Product leadership. Yeah. Thank you, Cody. Yep. Two of us will be able to do this. Product leadership. And then on the right bottom point, I want you to think about customer intimacy. Okay. Mm-hmm. And then at the lower left, I want you to think about what we call operational excellence. Okay. So product leadership, customer intimacy, and operational excellence. Now, why does this matter? Here's the thing. I want you to draw a little dot in the center of that triangle. Every business needs to decide which of these three points of the triangle is the most important, ultimate thing that you have to be so good at that nobody else in your market, none of your competitors, are stronger than you at that one thing. One of those three things. And the two other areas that you don't choose, you have to be good enough not to be at risk of going out of business and making your customers unhappy, but you have to be so good at the one area you pick that nobody else can say that one of your competitors is better than you are. And Michael Treacy talks about, if you're going to be a leader in your market, you have to be good at one of these three things.
Yep, and sort of plant your flag there.
Yes.
And this, what I love about this, Pat, is I always, even before I knew this model, I was always fascinated by, like, why are there so many companies in a bunch of different companies in the same industry? And why doesn't one of them put the other people out of business? And the answer is actually implied in this model, is because as customers are drawn to one of the three of these things. And actually, one of the ways that I end up describing this a lot is in the context of, like, coffee companies.
Yeah, well, let's do this. Let's come up with coffee companies and where they fit on this triangle? Because a lot of us drink coffee and we know these places. So right away, let's go to product leadership. This means this. It's the company that makes the best product, the best coffee.
Yeah.
And it's probably priced higher. And if you're a connoisseur of coffee, you would say, that's the place I go to get the very best coffee I can get. I'm willing to pay for it. It's unique. And they are constantly inventing better coffee. And I don't know, Cody, what is the coffee shop, coffee store out there where that, what that would be?
Well, this is where you get exposed, because coffee snobs will be like, oh, that's not the best coffee. But I think in our area, if you think of those elements that you talked about, like a really great cup of coffee, higher priced, and that you're okay with it. And I think there's a coffee company, at least on the West Coast, called Phil's Coffee, which is, you know, you go there and it might be a $6 cup of coffee, which compared to other ones we'll talk about, the Starbucks or others, seems high, but it actually, the quality of it is much higher. And that's what you're paying for.
And it might take a little longer.
Yeah, exactly.
But coffee aficionados would go, you got to go to Phil's. Now, maybe there's regional ones all over the place. You know, what is that one, Blue Bottle? Is that, I don't know. Is that
in San Francisco, or like Spyglass? Those would probably fit in that category too, which is like, they pride themselves on the actual roasted bean cup of coffee product. You know, like that's what they're going to market as a product leader.
Now let's talk about the operational excellence, because everybody's thinking this question, what about Starbucks?
Right.
And there's plenty of people that go, I love Starbucks coffee and all their products and everything, but there nobody who knows coffee will say that's the best cup of coffee you can get. Even if it's your favorite, and I don't mind it. I mean, I'm not a coffee snob. I don't really know one thing from the next. But Starbucks would be operational excellence. That means they have more stores in more locations and more volume, and they pump out coffee faster than anybody. And it's all about volume. Now, it's still not cheap, but it's definitely not the most expensive.
Right. And another way to put it is like that operational excellence, if you think of like big companies that have mastered that, it's a cheaper product that you can get faster, way convenient. There's a Starbucks on almost every corner. You know, like they have an app and you can, you know, order on your app and drive through and grab it on your way out. So, and we'll talk about at the end after we cover all three is like, what would threaten Starbucks is sort of an interesting conversation, because they've planted their flag on, and like you mentioned at the beginning, you have to be marginally good at the other areas. It's not like you can say if their product was absolutely terrible, then it didn't matter how operationally excellent they were or efficient they were. It would be, you know, nobody would go to their store. But they've done well enough at the other two that they're planting their flag on this side of, hey, it's going to be a really repeatable, really easy to receive, like you can purchase it really easily. And it's just an operationally excellent company.
And you have to say, they've done a remarkable job to make a pretty darn good product that you can buy on almost every street corner.
Right, exactly.
The other one would be customer intimacy. This means it's your company jumps through hoops for your customers. So it's about customization and knowing your customers and being flexible for them. Well, there's no big chains that do this. This would be the coffee shop on the corner. Cody, you used to have one. There was some of your friends had a coffee shop. They had two locations near you, right?
Right. And so this is exactly where they would plant their flag, is sort of in this customer intimacy thing. So if you think of it in the world of coffee, it's like you're standing in line. The person, the barista behind the counter already knows your name, has probably already started your order. They're trying to create an environment where you felt known. And the coffee is going to be pretty good and you're going to get it pretty quickly and it's not going to be too expensive. But what they're planting their flag on is the actual experience of going to that coffee shop. So these are the ones where you might want to go because of the location and the camaraderie that you experience there, and not necessarily just because it's product leadership or it's the fastest cup of coffee you can get.
Exactly. So we have some amazing coffee that's not everywhere. We have the one that's everywhere and volume, and they do a great job of producing these places. And then there's the customer intimacy. Here's the thing. There's room in a market for all three of those things. They're very different. The problem is, the day that somebody makes more coffee shops and is more saturated in the market than Starbucks, well, that's when hell freezes over, because I don't know how you could saturate it more. But that's their thing. The day that these ones like Phil's and Blue Bottle and every place has them, they have to be aware that somebody might come along and find a way to make a better product.
Yeah.
Because then they might be obsolete. And the one on the corner says, hey, as long as I'm good in this local area and I know my people, we're going to be okay.
Yeah. And I love that because the customer, we all have a different affinity and maybe even a different context. Like there is a time where I'm in a rush where I go to Starbucks specifically because it's fast and I know I can get through it really quickly and I'm going to get a decent product. You know, so this is why there's so many companies that exist in the same industry, because we're all drawn to want one of these three things. And I even think about it as it relates to our business, Pat, which is like, here's you could start a consulting firm, and we're not only a consulting firm, but...
No, but 25 years ago, we were only a consulting firm. We picked one, and it wasn't the one we have today. See, we changed.
Yeah, because here's the quick version of that is like, you could start a consulting firm saying, I'm going to use all the best... The product leadership consulting firm is like, I'm going to tell you, the client, what you need, and it's going to be the best offsite, the best engagement, the best like transformation that we can do. And that, or you can pick operational efficiency and say, or excellence and say, I'm going to have a ton of clients and I'm not going to charge a ton, but I'm going to get as many clients as I can.
A standard product, a standard service.
Totally.
And we're going to crank it out. It won't be that expensive.
Exactly. Or you can plant your flag on the customer intimacy as a consulting firm and say, hey, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to earn the trust of these people. And when they ask me to do anything, I'm going to say yes. So whether that is consult to the executive team or build a new performance management program or figure out how we hire and fire, you're just going to say yes because you are there to serve them. And all three of those are totally viable things.
And when we started our company, and my personality lends itself more, I think because of my dad and other things, to customer intimacy. That's how my dad was as a salesperson. So we would go out to our clients and we'd say, what do you need from us? We'll help you solve any. And they trusted us. And we'd say, yes. They'd say, jump. And we'd say, how high? And that was going great, but it didn't scale. And we actually, by the grace of God, wrote a few books and people started to see us as a thought leader in teamwork and organizational health and meetings. And suddenly we said, wow, wait a second. We have to shift our strategy. We want to have really high customer service, and we still do. But we have to have the very best solutions when it comes to teamwork, organizational health, and everything else we do. If somebody comes along and provides better solutions in that area, that will be a problem for us. So we literally shifted from a customer intimacy company to a product leadership company. And then when it comes to operational excellence, we suck at that. No, I mean, we do fairly, we have to control costs and do all that, but that's just so anathema or so anti our personality. So volume and standardization has never been our thing, and we're okay with that.
Well, and I think the interesting part of this, the applicable thing, is that oftentimes if you were to just write those three things on a board without this context of the model, really well-intentioned companies and leaders and startup founders are going to say, we should do all of them. We should be the best at being customer intimacy, and we should be the best at product leadership, and we should be the best at operational efficiency. And the thing is, you can't and you won't. And then what it will do is you'll fail at it. And so deciding is actually a good thing. Deciding which one you're going to be.
This is the most important message here, is that most CEOs I've worked with over the years, I explain this model to them and they say, yeah, we'll do all of those. And they get up in front of their employees and they go, here's the deal, you guys. We have to have the best product in the market. And we have to treat our customers better than anybody else. And we have to cut our costs and make ourselves more efficient and lean. And their employees are looking at them going, that's impossible. I don't know what my priorities are. And then they just go do whatever's right in front of them. And it's only the companies that dare to be strategic that will pick one and say, it's okay if we're not the best in the other two areas.
Right.
But so many leaders are like, no, I just can't say it. I just can't say we're not going to be that. And they set themselves up to peanut butter everything out. And you know what happens? They're not the best at any of the three. And somebody outcompetes them in every one of those areas.
Yeah. And it's so clarifying and actually probably gives you a ton of peace to be able to plant your flag on one of them and say, hey, we're okay. We're going to be good at those other areas, but this is the one that we're going to really max out on. It's funny, Bo was, who was going to join us on this podcast just last week, a couple weeks ago, his parents were in town and his dad is on an executive team at a hospital. And he was explaining the discipline of market leaders to his father. And there he was asking the question, hey, how do you think this applies to hospitals? And I thought, I was sort of cheeky about saying, well, I think it's probably the inverse. It's like, hospitals are none of these things. So as long as you can be marginally good at any of them, you might be successful. But what clarified it in their mind was they really are a hospital that values the customer intimacy. They think the doctor-patient relationship is the thing that brings people to that hospital and keeps them there. And so they actually had a conversation where another hospital is moving into their territory. And so asking the question, so what do we have to do to make sure that hospital, now there's hospitals all over and there's lots of businesses in the same territory. What do we have to do to make sure that our patients still are drawn to us? It was kind of an interesting conversation because there's an argument to be made that there's so much frustration in the process of hospital that if you actually became more operationally efficient, it might feel like customer intimacy, you know, like, oh, hey, I'm less frustrated here. But it really gave them clarity about we need to lean into this, not just from the doctor-patient relationship, but the holistic hospital has to embrace this idea that we need to be customer intimacy.
Yeah. And you know what's, so imagine that. So you're the CEO of a hospital and somebody says, are you telling me that you're not going to have the very best technology and medical practice?
Right.
And they have to be able to say, listen, when you're in a hospital, the bar is very high, mm-hmm. but yes, there will be some procedures that another hospital might come in and offer and people will pay a lot of money. And we're going to have to say, we don't do that. You might have to go to that hospital, but that doesn't mean you have a free pass on excellence. It just means somebody else could exceed you and you're going to be okay with that. Let's use another example that people can relate to. Let's look at department stores or places where you can buy clothes, let's say. Okay, let's talk about operational excellence. There's probably two companies that have been competing to be the best in this area for years. What would you say those are, Cody?
Well, Walmart has got to be one of them, right?
Walmart is one of them, and probably Target is another.
Yeah.
Now, I have a lot of friends, mostly my female friends, who love to go to Target, my wife included, and they'll say, they have great stuff, but they will say, no, it's low cost, there's Targets everywhere, and really, you can look across the map of the United States and see Targets and Walmarts all over, because they're tons of them, they sell a lot of volume, lower prices. Now, Target does a pretty nice job with their merchandising. Walmart can in certain areas too, but those definitely are the operational. They want volume and margin, or low margin, high volume.
That's a great example of they've planted their flag on the operational excellence corner, but they can't just sell really terrible products. They still have to be decent enough at product leadership. Otherwise, they'd go out of business. So that's great because it's not, you're saying like, oh yeah, Target still has some great stuff. They do. They have to be proficient. But it's not they're not planting their flag there.
Right. Because on the product leadership, it would have to be somebody like someplace I don't know, Saks Fifth Avenue. No, not even that. It's higher than that, like Neiman Marcus.
Right.
Or a boutique. Or some, I mean, you know, what is that shoes that everybody, they called us to work with them years ago, but we didn't get a chance to do those. That woman who makes the shoes in New York.
Boy, you're asking the wrong guy.
I know it. Everybody here will know. The ladies in our office are going to make fun of us. But like some amazing retailer that is, it's expensive, it's the best you can buy, and that's great.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, what about customer intimacy in department stores? Now, in the old days, we would say it's your local department store.
Yeah.
But there just aren't those around anymore. And there's only one department store that's nationwide that I would say has a reputation for being customer intimate, and that is Nordstrom.
Right.
And in the old days, I will say this though, there's a guy that works at my Nordstrom here, and he's been there for at least 24 years because when my sons were born, he became my personal shopper. He's still there. He has a local clientele. He knows me. He knows what goes on with my family. And Nordstrom said, in a world of retail clothes, we still want to have a relationship with our customers, which is why we let them return things and do all that kind of stuff. So Nordstrom is the only big-ish company that I can say really tried to do that.
Yeah, that's a great point because that maybe is the only example of customer intimacy at that scale. You know,
right.
that they actually found a way to scale up to that size is remarkable. But more often you're going to talk about like I think of when I think of customer intimacy and where we can buy clothes is that store down the street venture that you and I love, where that you walk in and they like walk you around and say, here's what you should buy your wife. And I'm like, great. That's exactly what I wanted. You know,
exactly. Cause they know you and they know what you want. What's ironic about that is they have really good products too, but it wouldn't be the best, but they still can charge for the service. Mm-hmm. I don't go there because I want to get the cheapest price that I can find on the internet. I go because they help me procure or curate what I want.
Yep.
Now, what's interesting is now let's look at a company that hasn't chosen in the area of retail that hasn't chosen any of these things and how they struggle. Macy's. Okay. Does Macy's have the best products in the market? No.
No.
Does Macy's have great service? They know when you're there and they take care of you? No.
Yeah.
Do they have the cheapest products and volume and you can always go there and they're always open and all that? No. This is a company that's been struggling for the last 15 years because they're not the best at any of these.
Mm-hmm.
And years ago, they really needed to pick. Are we going to be great at service? Are we going to be great at product? Or are we gonna go for high volume? Yep. And the problem is they're not sure who they're competing against. And if you just walk through their store, and with all due respect to them, it's hard to know what's going on there. You know? Yep.
You know, you're not picking on anyone. There are so many businesses out there actually that try to do all three of these or feel like we did, a tension between two of them. Which of these are we gonna be? And what I've found in the conversations that I've had around this model is it's so liberating for a company or a leader or even, you know, a startup endeavor to choose one of them and just say, hey, this is that makes sense, because I was in this tension of feeling like, boy, we have a great product, but we want to serve these people really well. Which one should I let the ball drop on? And that's really kind of the conversation is, hey, there's going to be a few balls that drop. Make sure you know that they're dropping in those two categories that you're not. You know
what's interesting, Cody? You know where people get into, and that's exactly true. You got to know which balls can bounce and which one will break. I think one of the problems people have is they think about marketing, because no company is going to go out and market. Like Starbucks isn't going to go, average products, but you can find us and we'll get it to you quickly. They have to market the quality of their product because marketing is not always about, I don't want to say it's dishonest, but you just can't market so nakedly that people will go, well, you have crappy products. Walmart doesn't say, come get crappy stuff, but at least it's cheap. And I'm not saying everything they sell is crappy, but compared to other places, it's not that great. So when I look at, like, in the fast food arena, okay, I look at, there are some that are, like, I would say Subway is operational excellence. They're everywhere.
Yep.
They have the same trough of food that you pick from, and you know what you're going to get. You're going to go through quickly. It's still really cheap.
Yep.
Okay. In fast food, I would say Chick-fil-A is about customer intimacy.
I think it's, so too.
For one, there's not one on every corner. They haven't like built out, they're everywhere, but not really that ubiquitous.
I was having this conversation the other day because I was saying, people are like, I don't get it. Chick-fil-A is not the best chicken sandwich. I was like, I don't go there for the chicken sandwich. I go there because every single person is so kind and so nice and so happy, and they're way operationally efficient too, but really it's the customer intimacy piece. The product they're selling is the service, you know, and then they happen to make chicken sandwiches. I love this example.
Yeah. And now nobody at Chick-fil-A, they would be offended if you said they don't have the best, but there's other places that are trying to make better chicken sandwiches. And deep down inside, strategically, they know this: if this isn't the friendliest place to go, we're going to lose our business.
Right. It is, by the way, my favorite chicken sandwich. I was just objectively saying maybe there's a better one out there. You know?
Well, and there are people like Popeyes makes, some people, I like Popeyes more. It's like, that's not the point. You don't go to Popeyes and they don't talk to your children and tell you to have a great day and do extra things for them. And now here's the interesting thing. Now, this could be controversial. You know what fast food place I think is product excellence? I think it's Taco Bell.
Really?
Let me tell you why. I know you're thinking. You know why?
We have to, Matt, erase the podcast. We have to erase the podcast.
Taco Bell, they're constantly inventing new products. Mm-hmm. And their commercials are all about, now the bean chalupa with, and they take them off the menu and on the menu. And everything they do is about that. Is their service great? No. They're okay, I guess. Mm-hmm. it's not ubiquitous. They don't have like Subway is on every dang corner. You know, Domino's is everywhere. I like Domino's stuff though. But the point is, I think Taco Bell really, by the way, if you go to Taco Bell too, it's not cheap. It costs a lot more to eat at Taco Bell and to get these products they're making, these new inventions that they're constantly doing. I think that in fast food, they are going for product differentiation. Now,
interesting.
That's a weird thing to do, but you usually charge more when you're doing that too.
Right.
So we could debate this. I know there's like other ones that are more upscale than Taco Bell, but in that area, what do you think is the most product leadership fast food?
I know that's a toughie because that fast food industry is not known for product leadership in terms of product quality. But I like your point. It's more about innovation and always changing and stuff like that. I don't know. That genre is kind of difficult. Maybe like Chipotle. I have no idea.
Yeah, that might be one because that's another good one. That's different. That might even be better. Chipotle isn't as cheap as going to Burger King. But they've advertised that it's fresh and they also do that. But somehow I still love Taco Bell, but I love Chipotle too. All right. So what we're saying here is just this. I hope this was fun. This was a little brain candy for everybody. But when you're in a business, small or large, you got to pick one and be the best at it. Don't be tempted into being mediocre or even average in all of them because that's a recipe for failure.
That's right. That was
fun.
And
that's it today. All right. Hey, thanks for joining us. This is fun. Cody, thanks so much. And God bless. We'll talk to you next time on At the Table.